God chose to use one guy to defeat Goliath, not an army. Okay, so I want to give you time to process it, you know? So, you know, as we get more mature in life, it takes a little longer to process material and stuff. So we are honored to be here today. And I'm going to introduce to you Team Challenge. This is Will and Mary Kitchen. We are honored that they have a heart of service. And we are going to be blessed beyond what we could ever imagine. But we want to take a moment today, and we're going to open our service with prayer. Pam Wilcox, who volunteered to oversee the cleaning of the restrooms, the most important job in this church, is probably at the ER right now. She's been sick for about 2 weeks. And Jim, her husband, and Tori, her daughter, left yesterday morning on the mission trip. And so they're up in Gulfport, Alabama. But Jim is packing and on his way home. I think she just got dehydrated. I don't know for sure. But she's in the ER right now. But we're going to stop. We're going to pray. Would you pray with me? Father, we know that the mighty God and mighty hand of our Creator can change the affairs and the course that we are on. So we are trusting, Father God, that as Pam is being ministered to, we're asking you to increase the wisdom, increase the understanding, increase the knowledge of every single person that has anything to do with her care. Father, we at this moment, in the name of your capable Son, release her care to you. We know you can do that because we've had many, many people experience miracles. And we rejoice, Father, in knowing that you are touching lives. So thank you for being here with us today. We thank you in the name of Jesus for blessing this presentation. And may the Spirit of God rise and bring us to a new place in life because we chose to honor you. Thank you for blessing the Teen Challenge Ministry, not only in this service today, but in the future of changed lives in the future. And we give you praise. Praise because you are our Father. Praise because you sent your amazing Son. And praise because the Holy Spirit is here with us. We've gathered in your name. Amen. Well and Mary.
Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. Would you stand with us? We are from Team Challenge here in Fort Myers, and we'll talk a little bit more about who we are and what it is that we do. Most importantly, we're here to proclaim the name of Jesus together with you. And so we're going to worship and share some testimonies and a few other things today. I know it's going to be a little bit different than what you're used to, but hopefully it can be glorifying to Him, and we can please Him, our Father, today. So let Him be praised. Let Him be lifted up and exalted in all we do. Amen. Standing just for a moment, we're gonna do a little bit different. Tara's gonna come up and briefly share her testimony. One of the things that we do in our services and make part of our worship is giving testimony, because we just believe that us declaring the goodness of God, us declaring the things that God has done, has the ability to continue to call us all out of our circumstances, out of our mindsets and where we are, and to be rooted in Him. And so be uplifted and encouraged as we continue in worship as Tara shares.
Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Tara, and I am 42 years old. I grew up outside of Atlanta, Georgia. Growing up, I grew up in a Christian home, a very loving, structured home, where God was the center of our family. We were always together, and when I was 12, we moved to a different state, and that's when God was taken out of the center of our family. Within a year, my parents were divorced, and my family fell apart. I did not know how to cope with that, so by the age of 15, I was drinking, I was smoking cigarettes, I was doing drugs, and I quit school. By the age of 20, I was addicted to crack, and I spent probably the next 10 years addicted to many different types of things, different drugs, different jobs, work. My work was very consuming. I was definitely addicted to a lot of things. Money was one, and I just ended up losing everything. Every time I turned around, I was losing something. And the last 5 years of my addiction, I lost everybody in my family, my mom, my dad, my three sisters, and then my two children. My health got really bad, and I had to place them where they are right now today. And I didn't know how to deal with that as a mother. When you lose your children and you don't know how to fix things, it's definitely hard to cope with that. So I got deeper into my addiction, and I ended up being the worst I ever was in my addiction. I lost everything, and I figured that I could probably just once again fix it myself, and that did not work. I ended up almost dying myself in a hotel room after losing one of my best friends. She died from an overdose, and then one of my other best friends lost her daughter to an overdose. And just, I was so thankful that God pulled me out of where I was, and He just kept making my path as straight as possible to get to Teen Challenge, where I came last March. And ever since then, God is like picking up all of my brokenness, all of my heartache, all of my hurt, and He's completely restored my hope. I walk in freedom. I walk in confidence today, knowing that I will be back with my family. He's restoring those things that I've lost. Next week, I get to spend 5 days with my twin sister and her child that I only have spent like five seconds with, basically, in the last 4 years. So God is moving in my life, and I am so thankful that I was able to come to Teen Challenge and be able to just focus on my relationship with Jesus. And now I walk in peace and hope and love and confidence. And I thank you for letting me share.
Amen. God, you are worthy of praise. God, there are some things that only you can do. Only you can bind the brokenhearted and heal us and deliver us. And Lord, we turn to you, our deliverer today, our healer, our restorer, the binder of our brokenness. God, we lift those things up to you today, Lord, even in worship, declaring that we don't take control. We let go of our pride to think that it's in our own hands. God, we release it to you today. God, we thank you for fighting our battles. We thank you for winning our battles, and that we can rest in you. Hallelujah.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see an empty tomb. Shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God, an almighty fortress. Yeah, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted.
Yes, God, the battle belongs to you. And Lord, we give it to you. We honor you this day, Lord, by releasing everything into your hands, our very hearts, our very lives. Lord, everything that we're about, that you may have control. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
In the chair back in front is a card. It's our communication card. And if you're a first-time guest, we are so honored that you are here with us today, and we welcome you. We usually are around 100 to 120 strong, so I don't know if somebody pulled a plug and drained the bridge or something happened, but we are mighty in small numbers. Amen? Praise the Lord. I know there's a lot of people out of town this week, too. But if you would fill out that communication card and just let us know that you were in the service today. We'd love to give you a call. We'd love to just answer any questions that you might have about this ministry, what's going on, and where we're headed in life. And so we are excited to be continuing to do what God's called us to do. Also, if you flip that card over, is our prayer communique. We have a prayer team that meets on Tuesday. There are ladies and gentlemen that come here to the facility, and there's a lot of other individuals that I text those messages out to, and that's the only folks that see those cards. They're held in confidentiality, and they are prayed over, and then we sign each card to let those individuals know we are serious about God answering prayer. Amen. Well, that's what we're going to do. There's not a lot of announcements coming up. We are not having a picnic on July 4th because we just had so much going on in the last couple of weeks and months that we're going to look forward to Labor Day, and we're going to celebrate with a picnic on Labor Day over in the Fellowship Hall for you that don't like the heat. And it'll be a great day. This time we're going to pray for our offering, so the gentleman will come forward. We're going to pray and just trust the Lord that God is supplying our needs according to his riches in glory. I don't know if you've noticed, but there was over $6,500 worth of microphones installed this week. And so the sound is much clearer and much crisper, and it doesn't have to be as loud for you to be able to hear it. And so we are excited about what God is doing here. Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and glory. We give you the honor for everything that you're doing financially, because we know who owns all the cattle. And we thank you, Father, that you are supplying our needs according to your riches. We continue, Father, to pray in the name of Jesus for Neil and all the adults and students on the mission trip. And we rejoice in knowing that it's been over 10 years since this church was able to send a mission team out. So we continue to give you praise and honor your name because of that. We thank you, Father, that we are supporting 5,000 missionaries, not only in the States, but around the world. So, Father, as we give to you, we trust that every single dollar is spent wisely and with your wisdom and your will in mind. Thank you for blessing those that are giving today. Thank you that those will give in the future of themselves, of their time, of their talent, and their treasure. We thank you in the mighty, powerful, amazing name of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
so kind to me.
Good morning, everyone.
My name is Steven. I've been in Teen Challenge now for exactly 12 months, and it has been an amazing experience. But me coming to God is not something, it's not a journey that began only 12 months ago. It started actually more like 3 years ago. And it wasn't something that came to me easily. I fought, I kicked, I screamed. I tried everything I could do to continue to hold on to my will in the way that I wanted to live. At the time, I was I had been clean for a certain amount of time, quite a few years, and I had had a relapse. This is about 3 years ago. And I was living in Philadelphia. When I relapsed, it came back. It was much worse than what I had been going through before. I had basically just started making up for lost time. I started doing things that I told myself I would never do. I started living a life that was just out of control, with no care or any type of, I don't really know, but I, what happened was, I was married, and my wife had overdosed and died, and it was very difficult for me because I felt guilty, I felt responsible. I loved her very much, but I was never really able to show her because of how selfish I was and how wrapped up in my own drug addiction. And when she needed me, that I wasn't there. I wasn't able to be there emotionally or to be able to help her. So I kind of fell more deep into despondency. I basically had given up on life, and I had resolved that I was just gonna keep getting high until whatever happened. My mother, who actually was a drug addict and did time in prison, had reached out to me, and she knew the type of situation that I was in and what I was going through, and she had asked me to come to Florida to, you know, try to start over and get a new chance on life. And at the time, I really didn't want to. I kind of avoided my mother because she was a very devout Christian and had found Jesus. And I didn't want to hear about that because it made me feel guilty. So she brought me to Florida. And when I got here, it was basically the same thing. I had just picked up where I left off. I found all the places here in Florida that you could get drugs, and I continued to do them. I was a liar, a manipulator. I stole, not just stole like things of value, but stole people's confidence in me. And my family, I alienated them and isolated them until finally they told me about Teen Challenge. And I was not receptive about coming here. I didn't want to commit myself to such a long period of time. Plus, I didn't really feel like that I felt that I had the answers and that I could do, even though my whole life before that had been, you know, basically misery and failure. When I came here, I remember first coming in and I remember wanting to leave. One of the guys who was in there, who was on laundry at the time, was talking to me every day, and he convinced me to just pray. And I did. And I prayed for just perseverance and the ability to stay, just to stay that first week or first bit of time. And I was able to do it, and I was able to get through it. And then what I started to realize was that if I turned over what I wanted to do, and I turned over my will and gave it over to Jesus, that things became easier for me, that I started to live through him. What Teen Challenge taught me is that drugs are really just a symptom of what's wrong with me, of what's wrong with people that have issues with their life. What was going on with me was much deeper. I was searching in the world for things to fill the emptiness that I felt, but there was nothing in the world that I could find, there was nothing out there that could fill what was wrong or fix what was wrong with me. I found that in Jesus. And to say that I'm a different person 12 months later is an understatement. I've gotten back everything that I've ever lost that I thought was important, plus much, much more. I'm a different person. I have hope in my life now. I have freedom. And this is something that I never had. And I owe that to Jesus Christ, and I owe that to Teen Challenge. So I just want to say thank you.
Well, good morning again. My name is Will. I'm the director of Teen Challenge here in Fort Myers. Teen Challenge is a one-year residential program for individuals struggling with addictions and life-controlling issues. We exist to put hope within reach, and that's the key. We can't shove it down anybody's throat. We can't force anybody, but we can put it within reach and know that if Christ is within reach, when he is reached for, he can do the miracles. He can do whatever it is that is necessary. He can pull us out of any of our deepest, darkest pits. But we offer life transformation through Christ-centered programs. We believe that he is the center, that he is the first, and he is the beginning, and he's the one that leads us and carries us through. Teen Challenge started in 1958. A small town country preacher named David Wilkerson in Pennsylvania, saw an article about some boys on trial in New York City, and when he looked in their faces, he saw something and believed that God told him to go to New York and to help those boys. There's a story called The Cross of the Switchblade, which is a New York Times best-selling book and a movie that was made that tells of his story of faith, of trusting in God to do something powerful, and he never got to save or help the boys that were on trial, but 64 years later, Teen Challenge now has about 300 centers around the United States. We have about 1,400 centers around the world. There are nations where churches aren't allowed that Teen Challenge is able to go into because there is just no answer for addiction outside of the power of Jesus. And so God has used the ministry in such a powerful way beyond what David Wilkerson or anybody else ever could have hoped or imagined. And what we want to share today is that we are here as a resource for you. I'm not going to get into major details about the program and the ins and outs. If you have questions about those things, certainly we would love to chat with you. And we have a table out in the foyer where you could come and speak to us and ask some questions. As I said before, there's two things that we want you to know. Number one, that we're here, that we have a men's program, we have a women's program, and so as you meet those, or maybe you know those in your family or workplace that need the hope of Jesus Christ to break free from addiction, we exist as a resource for you. The Bible says that we are one body with many parts, and that's not just those of you who are in this room. That's the body of Christ collective, and so we offer an opportunity, a discipleship mechanism that maybe you can't provide here in this local house, but in through the connection in the body of Christ, it is provided. Number two, we just want you to know that Jesus Christ is alive. He still reigns. He's still king. He still pursues and seeks out those that are lost to save and to heal and to deliver, and that's never going to change. His love is so much greater than we could ever ask for or imagine, and we want you to know that there is hope. Whatever you're struggling with or battling with today, there is hope in the name of Jesus. This is the third time that my wife and I have been able to be here on a rally just like this. We came down here to Fort Myers just a little under 2 years ago, September of 2020. We were actually serving at the Teen Challenge in Brooklyn, where Teen Challenge started all those years ago, and weren't looking to leave, weren't looking to go anywhere, especially where it was extremely hot. But God called us down down here on the telephone and offered us the opportunity, and we responded, and we've been here, and we absolutely love it, and are so grateful for what God is doing, and where He has brought the ministry from the place of all of us were in 2 years ago, in the midst of the pandemic and the confusion and everything that's gone on in the last few years, and what He continues to build on our campus and through our ministry there in Fort Myers. And so we would love to meet with you at the table in the back. I'm actually going to ask the ladies who are a part of the next skit to go ahead and come in and get in place. At the table out there, you will find opportunities that you can support the ministry. There are crafts and crosses and candles and all sorts of things, all made by Teen Challenge students that go to directly support the program. We have a monthly sponsorship that we'd love for you to take part in, where for just $30 a month, you can sponsor someone and help us to continue to put hope within reach. And we would love for everyone today to grab a business card or a brochure to take with you, so that you have a resource in your hand available when you meet those that are struggling and in need of hope, and you can give that to them, and they can have a place that they can go. And so the ladies are going to do a skit today, and then I'm going to come back up and share a few things from God's Word. But we hope that you are blessed. We hope that your faith is encouraged today, and that you continue to press into Jesus, who is the answer for all of our needs.
What is reality? Reality is being sexually abused every day from the age 6 to 13, being forced to kneel in prayer for forgiveness, and being betrayed by your own mom when that truth finally came out, leaving you with a mountain of shame, guilt, fear, and mistrust. Reality is being in full-time ministry, being caught in an extramarital affair, being stripped of everything you've come to know, turning your back on God, leaving you with even more shame and more guilt. Truth is, living in total isolation, completely losing your identity, turning to alcohol to numb your pain, and waking up in the hospital several times, not even sure of how you got there. How do I know that's reality? Because that was me.
Reality is refusing all help from your family and friends because you think that you can stop drinking on your own and you're so prideful. Reality is being forced to write your will because your parents think that you're going to die in your addiction. Reality is being so intoxicated that you're getting kicked off flights and banned from airlines. How do I know that's reality? Because that was me.
Reality is taking care of my sister Teresa, who was suffering from cancer, and watching her take her last breath and choosing alcohol to deal with the loss and pain. The reality is not being there for my husband and three children because I was drunk. The reality is receiving a DUI, selfishly disregarding the law and the safety of others. How do I know what reality is? That was me.
Reality is being an identical twin, constantly being compared, leaving you feeling unseen and less than. Reality is growing up in a stable family, and then all of a sudden your parents are divorced and your sense of stability is pulled out from underneath you. Reality is watching someone you love attempt suicide, not knowing how to cope, so you turn to the needle that almost took your own life. How do I know that's reality? Because that was me. Even though we all have different realities, we are all changed by the same truth. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. Truth is, I am an original masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good work. And my value comes from my creator, not from comparison. Truth is, my family may not have been perfect, but God, my Father, has restored my sense of stability I lost when I was a child. And truth is, I now know how to cope through hardships because God is the God of all comfort, as it says in 2 Corinthians 1:3.
The truth is that my sister Teresa is with Jesus, and I find comfort in that. The truth is that I have found Jesus, and He has given me love. He's given me peace and happiness for a new life, to be a mother and a wife. The truth is, I have the Holy Spirit in my heart, and He is teaching me to obey the laws and to live life sober and to live life free.
Truth is, God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. Truth is, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but God came to give me life, life abundantly. And truth is, no man can stop what God has planned for my life. I just returned from my first missions trip to Costa Rica, and I plan on continuing to fulfill the Great Commission.
Truth is, God has lovingly healed my childhood wounds, and through that same love, I have been able to forgive those who hurt me. Truth is that what the enemy meant for evil, God has turned for good, and He is restoring broken relationships. And truth is that God's grace is more sufficient than any of my former realities. He has redeemed me, and He has called me, and I am running boldly into the direction of His call on my life. And God said that you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Amen. Good job, ladies. Isn't that good? You know, we all have trials that we face, struggles that we go through, and every single one of us needs the truth. But we also have to remind ourselves and tell ourselves the truth. One of the principles that we discuss often in our staff and intern meetings is that the voice that we hear most every single day, the person that we have the conversation with the most, is ourselves. And so we have to be mindful about the conversation that we're having with ourselves. And this is not just positive thinking and modern psychology. This is the power of God that He has given us. This is a command that He has shown us to continue to talk about and tell about and proclaim the awesome things that He has done. Why? Because we have an enemy of our souls that would love to rob those God stories from us. He would love to twist and turn and to get us isolated and broken. But we also have a mind that can be so easily distracted and so easily confused and so easily broken down if we're not careful. David showed us this often, and often you hear in the Psalms, "Cry out, O my soul," as if he was talking himself into and reminding himself of the great things that God has done. And there's a powerful story in 1 Samuel, I think chapter 30, where David goes through one of the most difficult times of his life, finds that his family has been taken from him, the town has been burned down, and it says that he strengthened himself, or the King James says he encouraged himself in the Lord. And of course, we know in the New Testament, Paul tells us to rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. And in 1 Peter, he says, "I continue to remind you of these things because you need them. You need to know them." You see, when we go through hard times, when we feel lost, when we feel alone, when we feel weak, when we feel broken, it is in that time that we need to talk to ourselves, remind ourselves, and to be rooted in the things of God. If you have your Bibles, you can open up to Psalm chapter 16 today, and I want to talk to you about the power to not be shaken. Everybody say, "I will not be shaken." I will not be shaken. Reality says sometimes that our world begins to shake. Reality says that things often happen that are out of our control. Reality says that we'll make mistakes. Reality says that we're not going to be perfect. But truth is, I will not be shaken because of the power of Christ that dwells in me. You see, Psalm 16 is a powerful example of what all of this looks like biblically. Another time where David spoke to himself, where David called it out of himself to overcome his difficult situation. And so let's read. I'm going to read from the New International Version, but whichever one you choose to read out of is perfectly fine. They're all good. "Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at my right, even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. And that is our theme verse for the year here at Teen Challenge. Verse 9, therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful ones see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This psalm is a psalm of confidence and not lament. A song of lament would look something like, oh God, please save me because everyone is out to kill me and there's nothing good in my life and I don't know which way to go and I'm just lost. And it just focuses on the negative and it focuses on the enemies and it focuses on the frustrations and the powers of the enemy and the pain. But this psalm of confidence does not focus in all of those things, but rather it focuses on praising God, praising God's people, focusing on the positive things that God has done and his pleasure of good standing with God and with other people. You see, this is a psalm of confidence rooted in relationship of the power of God to both save and to sustain along the path of life. Both to save and to sustain. And I find that many people struggle with one of those two things. Either they believe, I have a hard time believing that God has the power to save, maybe because their situation is so dire or lost or dark that they're not sure if God has the ability, but maybe they believe that, yeah, he had the power to save, to pull me out of the darkness, but maybe they don't trust in his power and ability to sustain along the paths of life. We get distracted. We see our problems. We see the things that we go through, and then we see the person of God standing on the other side. And David would say that we've gotten that a little bit out of order. You see, David knew God's track record, and that's how he knew that he was able to call upon and trust in and believe God in this way. He often had to take walks through memory lane to remind himself of what God had done. And this is what God had asked the people to do from the beginning. Many of the festivals and the feasts and the rituals that they had were there to help them to remember and to do this very thing, to speak the goodness of God continually into their lives, but they often missed the mark. But David trusted in God's track record, and so he made a few statements here that helped him to stay on track that we can learn from today. He opens the psalm and he says, God, keep me safe, for I take refuge in you. You see, that word refuge essentially means to flee to for protection. We flee to. It's a conscious choice to put our hope and our trust in God in the midst of trials and struggles and difficult times. And so when we face those moments, often our flesh is going to want to become weak. Our flesh is going to want to quit. Our flesh may want to give in, but it is by conscious choice that we put our hope and our trust in God and we flee to him, which means we run from something else. David says, it is in you I take refuge. Keep me safe. And he affirms his position in God by saying, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. This is why I run to you, God. This is why I'm coming to be found once again to you, because I'm running from all of the things that are meaningless, all of the things that would try to rob my soul, all of the things that would try to break me down. God, I run to you because apart from you, there's no good thing. He acknowledges the people. He says, yeah, the people that love God, yeah, these are my people. These are the people that I want to surround myself. These are the people that I want to trust in and I want to be part of and have in my life, because I know that those who do not will continue to suffer more and more. But that's the life that I'm trying to leave behind. So those people that run after, and essentially is what it says, there's a contrast between two different kinds of people: those that flee to God and those that flee to other things. Meaning those that take life into their own hands and find something else to be their God, or those that say, you know what, I have no good thing apart from God, so in the midst of my trial and my circumstance, I'm going to drop it all and I'm going to run to him. And when I run to him, I'm going to be found in his goodness, surrounded by a community of people that can help me stand firm in the midst of my situation. And you see, this idea of running to other gods or idol worship can sometimes seem a little bit foreign to us, because we don't run to Baals and Marduks and sun gods and all of these other things. But you know, those aren't the only types of foreign gods that we can pursue. Whatever we run after for provision or for protection or for presence, whatever it is that we put our hope in or a trust in above the power and the presence of God, that thing becomes an idol. Why? Because it's the same spirit that draws us to those things and away from God as it was from the beginning of time, that has always tried to draw people away to anything else other than the power of him and his presence. You see, David knows, if I want to be safe, if I want to have joy, if I want to make it through my circumstance, well, guess what? The Lord is my portion and he's my inheritance. The Lord is the one that's going to make me secure. The Lord is the one who is going to establish and is going to bless me. And I my mind goes to, and I know that Paul learned all of his theology from studying the Old Testament, and there's a scripture in Romans 8, verse 18, where he says that our present circumstances, our present trials are not worth comparing. Comparing to what? The glory that will be revealed, right? Whatever it is that we're going through doesn't stand a chance when placed in contrast to what it is our inheritance that we have in God. But what is it that sometimes we have to do? We have to consciously flee from those other things, and we have to consciously talk ourselves into running into the presence of God, which can be difficult sometimes because the things that we have to run from are tangible. And they're here, and they're present, and they're temporary, and we can get our arms around them, and we can grasp them, and so sometimes we find comfort in that. The difficult thing, even though God is all-powerful and awesome and all of those things, he's not necessarily something that we can just put our hands upon. And so we find it difficult. If I really run to him, am I going to find what it is that I'm looking for? And so it is by faith that we have to grab onto and hold onto the promises of God in our life. And so that's why we have to tell ourselves and remind ourselves and equip ourselves with what it is that we need to reject the things that are false, to run into that which is true, the power and the presence of God. And in doing this, David says, because all this is true, I will praise the Lord. He makes two declarations. I will praise the Lord, and I will keep my eyes on the Lord. When we're in difficult times, how often do we let the praise of God just fade away? How often do we talk more about or dwell more upon our trials and our problems than we do standing back and praising God? Because what happens is when we begin to praise God and God begins to become in the forefront of our minds and our face, and we keep our eyes upon him, we now see all of our problems and our circumstances through him, as opposed to seeing him through our problems and our circumstances. See, this is the ability to put God first in all things. The ability to put our hope and our trust in Him. It's getting our priorities straight. It's posturing ourselves to receive good things from the Lord. God becomes the filter through which we see everything else in the world. And we see Him and we see everything else the way He sees it and the way that He sees us. And therefore, David says, when I do this, when this happens, when I begin to praise the Lord, whenever I put my eyes upon the Lord only, there's a few things that happen. Number one, my heart is glad. The heaviness that maybe I once carried begins to fade away, and I can experience this peace. My tongue begins to rejoice. You see, people, we have a gift, and that gift is when things make us happy, we talk about them. We sing about them, right, Pastor? We make it known. We want other people to know what has happened. And so there's something just inherently wrong whenever God does something good for us and we keep it to ourselves. I just think that sometimes we haven't grasped the fullness of what God has actually done, because when we're excited, we immediately, yesterday I came home from the store and I didn't even have ice cream in my hand, but my son thought I had ice cream in my hand and he went running through the house telling everybody else, Daddy brought home ice cream, Daddy brought home ice cream. Why? Because he was excited about it. And I had to break his little heart and tell him, no, it was just baked beans. But our tongue begins to rejoice. And number three, we are secured. When we're in difficult times, that's one of the things that we lose immediately is our sense of security. When we lose our sense of security, we begin to try to take things into our own hands, and we do what I've done many times in my life, and we create Ishmaels, right? We try to do our own thing, make our own choices, our own plans, because we're insecure and we're trying to work it out ourselves. But when we put Him first, we become secure. And then the last one, we're filled with joy in His presence. And if the team wants to go ahead and get ready for our closing song, I'm gonna wrap this up. You see, we can experience joy in His presence. And that's not just something that we will get to one day. That's not just something that's waiting for us when we cross from this life to the next. You see, this is a declaration that we will experience God's presence both now and forevermore. We can experience eternal life with God. In fact, we should be experiencing eternal life when we ask Jesus into our hearts. We have received the eternal life of God. But sometimes we get confused. Sometimes we get broken down. Sometimes we struggle in the midst of life and we lose focus of the great gift that God has given us. You see, it's now that God wants to be involved in your life. It's now that God wants to teach you. It's now that God wants to embrace you. It's now that God wants to celebrate the great things that you do, and He wants to pull you close of the not so great things that you do. It's now that God wants to reveal Himself to you so that you can see Him instead of everything else. I'm reminded again of a New Testament scripture that I think must have been drawn from these principles in Matthew chapter 6:33 that says, seek first His kingdom and righteousness and all these things will be added to you. Jesus was telling His people, don't be anxious or broken down about life. Seek the Lord. God will take care of you. He'll take care of all of those things. The team is going to do one last collective testimony to a song called Pride of a Father. You see, the reality is that oftentimes we struggle. Reality is that we can get ourselves tangled in so many different things and we can feel the pressures of life. But truth is, we have a Father that desperately loves us, that outrageously cares for us, and that has gone to every single length possible to demonstrate His love for us when He gave His life on the cross for our sins. He left no question. He left in us an eternal symbol, not just a feeling, not just a story told long ago, but He left us something that we could see every single day of our lives to be reminded of His goodness. The team is going to do this song, and then I'm going to come back up and close here today.
it's a prodigal burdened by my shame till you came running to remind me your love is unconditional, and in your eyes I'm worthy of forgiveness. Oh, what was lost is now
sides of the sign shows what they talked about earlier, maybe reality, the place they found themselves. The flip side is what happened when truth got involved. You know, I think it's fitting for us to consider one more testimony today, since David was the one that gave this song. What happened when in David's life when he took his eyes off the Lord and placed it on other things? Early in David's life, he was pursued. He was a nobody, watching sheep, and he learned early to keep his eyes upon the Lord. As he got filled with pride, as he faced different circumstances and trials, he took his eyes off the Lord and he placed them on someone else instead of God. And it led to certain destruction in his life. Still loved by God, God restored him. Still used by God. But his own kingdom, his own life would never be the same. Today we have the opportunity to evaluate in our life any area where we've begun to take our eyes off the Lord and to look at other things. It starts small. It starts oftentimes not with something major. But this is why truth is so important, because you cannot head in the right direction until you know where you are. You cannot know where you're going until you know where you really are. And too often, we try to solve the problems in our life by just scrambling around in the dark, because we have not come to the light of truth. See, the light of truth has the power to expose the dark and to help us understand where we really are, so that God can help us get to where we really need to go. And so this is a message with a dual purpose today. Number one, it gives us the opportunity to return to Jesus and to see him first. But it also gives us the opportunity to declare again with David that as we focus our eyes upon him, we will be secured. We will experience the joy. We will experience the power of his presence now. Too often we just say, oh, I'll just make it to the end. One day God will heal me, and one day God will. No, now God wants to be present in your life. Now God wants to do great things in your life. Now God wants to move in a powerful way. And so if there's anybody in this auditorium today that would like prayer, any trial, any struggle, anything that you're facing, doesn't have to be sin. It could be anything. I would love to pray for you. Maybe even just for a moment, if we could just bow our heads and close our eyes, because I know that sometimes when we're in dark places or lonely places, when we're experiencing trials, it's difficult. Maybe if you just like prayer today, could you just raise your hand? Anything at all that you think that, you know what? I've been tempted. The enemy has been pushing me to run to something else, to choose something else, to see something else instead of God. And today, I want to declare with David, I will not be shaken. I will not be moved. I will stand upon the goodness of God and who he is today. And I will experience all of these things that David talked about in these Psalms. Father, you've seen the raised hands. And God, so often we can come and we can walk in church and we can play the game and we can put on a happy face acting as if everything is okay, but sometimes we can be dying inside. God, this is supposed to be the place where the balm of Gilead washes over our minds and our souls and restores us to that place of hope and security and trust in the one who has called us. God, you're not mad, you're not angry. You don't push anybody away. But God, I believe in you're in this place today to heal and to deliver and to save. And so God, for every one of those hands that has been raised today, Lord, I just pray your power, your strength, your spirit to take control. Lord, lift their eyes. You are the lifter of our heads. You are the one that instills us with peace, that instills us with confidence in who you are. So I just pray for that gift today, grace that they need to walk through their journey. And we trust in you. We know you will do it. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for allowing us to be with you today. I know that we went a little bit over, but I hope that today again, that number one, that you would understand that we are a resource to you. And there's any way that we can come alongside you and your family to provide hope, we would love to have a conversation. But number two, most important today, we just want you to leave with the knowledge and the commitment today that you will not be shaken.
morning.
Not because of us, not because of the message, not because of anything that happened today, other than the fact that you chose, made a conscious choice to flee to him, which means running from something else and fleeing to him, and that you will receive all of the promises that God declares over your life. Amen. When that happens. God is good, he is faithful, and he is for you. So we thank you, and God bless. Pastor.
Well, can we give them a hand one more time? You know, I've seen that cardboard testimony multiple times, but what God is impressing upon my heart, every single one of you are a miracle. And we got to witness a miracle live and in person today. So thank you for being willing to stand up for him and not be ashamed. God bless you. As you leave, there's going to be some men with guns and knives in the back, and you're not allowed out of here unless you give large amounts of money. Just kidding, okay? We are going to receive a benevolence offering for the team challenge. We do, as a church, part of our mission outreach, support them monthly, but we want to bless them over and above. So if you would pray, ask God to give you wisdom on what you can, you know, contribute today. If you cannot, you don't have anything with you today, just give them your credit card, it's all good. Okay, driver's license, so they have some identification. Just kidding, okay? We want to support them, and so if you could do that. If not, then you just let us know in the church office, and we'll make sure that they get every single dollar that comes in. We don't use any administrative fees to handle that. Also, every single male person in this room today has a gift before they leave. So we have gifts, and it does concern chocolate. So, okay, ladies, you'll just have to beg on your knees. I'm just kidding, okay? So we have a gift for you, gentlemen. Happy Father's Day. We rejoice. Thank you again, Will and Mary. We know the cost is great for you to come all the way down south. Have you had grits yet? Oh, okay. Let's pray, folks. Father, we thank you in the powerful name of Jesus our Lord. We thank you that we have witnessed lives that are miracles, walking, breathing, and talking here on this earth. Empower us to change our world one life at a time. So we charge forth out of this building in the name of Jesus to go make a difference in the power and the grace of a holy God, in whose name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you very much, and have a Jesus-filled day.